morning.
Yes.
So I had a very interesting experience with one of the organizers for this event. So I was told to come and speak at this event about 4 or 5 months back. Then you know I was invited because I was working at Microsoft. Then September 30th, I happened to resign from Microsoft. So then there was an issue. The issue was, what's my title now? What's my designation? So I said, I don't have a designation, you can call me whatever you want. So I went from director at Microsoft to technically a nobody right now because I don't have a job, I'm running my own thing. So I said, maybe the safest thing and a more sophisticated thing to call me would be an entrepreneur. Right? So I want to start off by talking a little bit about my own story. So I worked at Microsoft for 14 years. Teaches them these things. They know how to use the phone, they know how to unpack the phone, they know how to charge the battery, they put it on, they connect to the internet, they download all the different apps that they need, and they are connected. Perhaps we learn from them. Now, so the question is, are we letting our students play? Now, how do you play while learning? You can, right? So if you let our students play, can we now promote learner autonomy? Where learners or kids learn by themselves or people learn by themselves? Can they have higher retention? Right? As opposed to just, you know, memorizing stuff for the sake of it because you want to pass an exam. Can they have much more higher retention and therefore much higher effective use of application? Are these 21st century skills that we are talking about, or should these be the skills that we should be cultivating today in our students? Look at a very simple example. When I mentioned this to a colleague of mine, he asked me, are you serious? Cell phones in the classroom. So what do people do with cell phones? They either do Instagram, they do Facebook, they do Skype, or they write stuff. Now let's look at a very simple example. If somebody is using Instagram, right? If somebody is using Instagram, imagine you take selfies of yourself with some cultural stuff that you need to learn, and you hashtag each and every selfie with a certain word, what happens? Every time you want to retain all those learnings, all you type is the hashtag. Anyone else who wants to learn from their kid or the student who did something, all they type is the same hashtag and all the content comes up. In more sophisticated terms, this is called cognitive learning. Right? This is called cognitive learning. These can be used as a cataloging tool. Like hashtags can be used as a cataloging tool. Now look at Skype. What if people use Skype to facilitate virtual learning? Anyway, even if you are in the classrooms, most of the time when the teacher is teaching, they are in another world. So what if we, or the students, can actually use technology to facilitate further learning? And what if you do Skype to do virtual learning amongst a group of students, even across different countries? Then look at Facebook. The traditional norm is you waste time on Facebook. I am a huge Facebook user. If I'm not speaking, if I'm not working, if I'm not sleeping, I am probably on Facebook. Why? Because there is so much of knowledge. I don't read a paper today because it's full of junk anyway. Not that Facebook is not, but at least you will pick up something useful. Now, what if you use Facebook for much more effective usage to facilitate learning? People share assignments in groups. People talk about learnings in the group. People don't write stuff on notebooks anymore. What if you share all the learnings in a private Facebook group, shared amongst a few students or a learning group, and you've just been learning from? What about blogs and spaces? You know, what if a teacher tells a student, as opposed to by-learning stuff, both write about your learning about this particular topic in this particular blog and share about your experience to all your colleagues. Wouldn't that enhance learning as opposed to the traditional methods that we use today? On-demand learning. What is this? Tomorrow, if your sink is leaking of water, you would call someone to fix it. You call a plumber to fix it, or you might watch a YouTube video to go fix the sink. Now, why can't that same theory? Or if you want to apply some fancy makeup, you go and watch the fancy makeup videos which are on YouTube. Why can't that same theory apply for learning? If a student wants to learn something, why can't you just give the opportunity for a student, even during an exam, to go actually refer a video, learn something and write about it, as opposed to asking the students to come and memorize this and come and write for an exam? I just don't get it anymore. If stuff is out there on the internet, why do you need to stop everything up here? If you're smart and if you know how to locate all your information, or if you know how this stuff can be located, And if it's already out there, why stuff it in here as if we already don't have enough issues? Why stuff things that are stuff things here when it's already out there? I don't get it. If you do, please let me know. Right? And the other thing is this whole thing around learning equality. So I don't know where you heard this. So you get the poor kids, you get the rich kids. Or the kids who are born to rich parents, you get the poor kids who are not, the kids who are born to poor parents. How many times have you heard this saying from rich kids' parents? That they say, my son is extremely gifted. You know, my daughter, she's a special case, I tell you. Yeah, they do wonders with these computers. I don't know how they do it. They are so gifted. But the poor kid somehow is not gifted. Right? Now, we have not even tested that. But the fact is, the poor kid, because they don't have a computer or maybe a sophisticated phone as a rich kid, they are not gifted. Right? So there is a huge issue around learning equality. How do you provide the same quality of education, same quality of content or teaching or teachers, irrespective of which school or which institution you go to? How do you provide that level of equality? Have you ever thought about a classroom in the cloud where anyone can access? Same content, anyone can access. Right? So this needs to get fixed. In reality, from what I know, if children will learn to do what they want to learn to do. So children will learn to do what they want to learn to do. Whether you are a rich kid or a poor kid, that just happens. Groups of children can learn things using the computer and internet on their own, irrespective of who or where they are from. If you look at some of the brightest students today, not necessarily with all the internet facilities and all the sophisticated computer facilities. As a part of my job at Microsoft, before I used to go from one city to another. So I've covered Kandy to Kurunagala to Badulla to all these different places, right? And you get some really smart kids, and I ask them, how did you learn this stuff? So one kid designs websites somewhere in a very rural part in the country. I said, how did you learn this stuff? Oh no, there was this institution which just put two computers for 20 students, and I just went and learned it by myself. Now imagine if you provide more access, the kind of outputs you get. And nobody taught this kid. The kid learned it by himself. Right? And that's the kind of thinking we need to have, and that's the kind of access we need to broadcast to facilitate this level of learning. If children have interest, education happens. Now the question is, how do we generate interest? Can we generate interest using traditional methods? Probably not. But can we generate interest using some of these new methods, where we look at much more collaborative learning and sharing? Perhaps you can. So, if there is stuff out there, like I said, why stuff it in your head? Now, let me also talk a little bit about this experience we had around microbit. Now, let me tell you first what a microbit is. So, microbit was a very small device, it's a pocket-sized device. You could give it to any student, and the student can start learning programming. Right? So, you don't need a huge sophisticated computer or anything. The student can start to learn how to program or how to write code. Now the good thing about this microbit device is that it also has sensors. There's this huge revolution about IoT or Internet of Things. Internet of Things is a lot around sensors. So this microbit also had a couple of sensors. So a couple of volunteers, the guy on the left at the top is the owner of this project, 21-year-old guy who used to work for me at Microsoft, 23 years old. He was the pioneer of this project. So he wrote to BBC, he got this device. Completely out of his own will, nobody funded this, nothing, completely out of his own will, he got this device. He started teaching kids using device about how to write software code. Initiative was started about 3 to 6 months back. From what I know, about 1,000+ kids have been trained on this device about how to write code. And also in rural parts of Sri Lanka. Rural parts of Sri Lanka, ages of 13 to 16. Then there was this very recent competition around Mother's Day Global Challenge. The challenge was, do something interesting for your mothers using technology. And a couple of kids, not too far away from Colombo, in a place called Piliandale, again, not known for a lot of facilities, these kids, roughly about 13 to 14 years of age, build some interesting programs. One kid built a small program using a device which can detect if the fridge is being closed or not properly by the mother. Another kid built something where if the mother always goes to the supermarket, always comes home, forgetting to order things. So how do you track everything that you need to buy from the supermarket without using sophisticated software like this kid in there? So this is the kind of talent that emerged. Now this is only 1,000 kids. Now if we can broad base this to hundreds and thousands of kids, imagine the kind of output we get. Now how did we teach them? Right? Because I happened to be there in a couple of sessions. So how did we teach them? Now this is not me standing up and delivering a lecture on how to code. We spoke about here are some things you can do. This is this device. Here are some links you can refer. Here are some videos you can refer. Everything is left there. And these kids figure things out on their own and started building computer programs. Just using this device. Now the challenge we have is how do we scale this more? Right? Now the government is not funding this, no institution is funding this. This was a PO passion. But the fact is, this was an experiment to find. Can a kid who has absolutely no clue of software programming, can we teach them to program? That was the experiment. Answer is yes, we can. Can we do that using non-traditional methods? Yes, we can. Is it more effective than traditional methods of teaching? Absolutely yes. Absolutely yes. Right. So the one final thought is, you know, don't give children education. Make them want to take it. Right? Make them want to take it. I mean, if you use some of these new methods of teaching, of facilitating learning, chances are that they want to take it as opposed to being forced to learn. I think this forcing function would probably need to change. And if you can make the whole learning environment that much more fun, effective, non-traditional, chances are that as opposed to forcing learning down or education down, they would probably want to take it themselves. With that, I'll end my speech. Can I do a Q&A? I think we've got some time for Q&A. Any questions or anything you have? Is there a signal for me to leave? Go ahead.
Hi, that was really interesting. Thank you so much. I have a question about the project that you were describing. Were girls also involved in it, or was it mostly young boys who came forward? Because obviously that's an issue, isn't it, getting girls to be interested in technologies?
Girls too. So there was a fairly decent balance of gender. Still skewed more towards the boys, but the participation was not so bad. In fact, I think that's one of the things that the technology industry is trying to resolve in Sri Lanka. How do you get more female participation, not only at a coding level, but even at a much more senior leadership level. But the signs were encouraging. One of the things that we've discovered in Sri Lanka, it's a traditional mindset. Most parents want to make their kid a doctor or a lawyer or an engineer. And we've got to understand that not everybody is best to be a doctor or a lawyer or an engineer. One of the things we found out during these experiments is that no sooner we say, programmer, suddenly push back. I want my child to be a doctor or a lawyer or an engineer. Then we rephrase this and say systems, computer engineer. So somewhere down the line the word engineer is involved, so therefore it was a big word. Again, so it's all to do with traditions. Now, I'm very technologically sophisticated. If you take my household, when I told my household, my wife and my wife's parents and my parents, from the 1st of October, I'll be working from home. That was a huge culture shock. So what, you mean you're jobless? You mean you don't have a job, you don't have a pay? Is that how it's going to be? I said, no, we live in a connected world and it doesn't really matter where you work from. So if that happens even in my own household, where I work for 13 plus years, at Microsoft, at a top technology company, you can imagine how bad it is when you go outskirts. Yeah, so those are some things. Thank you for the question. Any other questions?
Right. everywhere, every country, everybody is thinking that education should be centralized. So all the country, they are all schools, colleges, all these are centralized. And every politician is thinking it is education should be like that. All the should come and get degree, certificate, and should be recognized in the job. Now, how to get out of this? That is a very difficult plan. Because already you said it is structured. Always we are thinking in that line. Now, how can we get out of this mind?
Any politicians in the room? I think fundamentally you've got to change the system. Fundamentally you've got to change the system. I'll tell you one. My daughter goes to Bishop's College. She's 5 years old. She wakes up at 6:30 in the morning. 5-year-old kid loves to sleep a bit more, especially when it's raining. Comes home absolutely exhausted at about 12. I'm wondering why. Of course, I tried explaining this to my wife and she forgets it. But the fact is, I don't see why. I'm fundamentally questioning the function of going to school. Because, like I said, if content is out there, if connectivity is out there, why do we need to go to school? Unless the school is offering something so great which you can offer at home, which I don't think it is right now based on what I'm seeing, why do you need to go to school? Now, this is not to say that you shouldn't send your children to school, so don't hold this against me. But to answer your question, I've been thinking about it. We've got to change the system. Starting from the Ministry of Education to all these places, I think there has been rapid progress in Sri Lanka in terms of making technology available for schools, which I think is a great thing. Now, my question is, we can't make technology available in schools or for children and still work the same way. Right? So in our world, we used to say, you know, you already have an inefficient manual system. Now let's use technology and make it an inefficient automated system. So that's not what we should try to achieve. Fundamentally, you've got to question what we want to achieve. Right? Now if you take, for example, in the most rural parts of India, they are teaching biotechnology using technology with no teachers. Right? Then in some of the most, I think in Karnataka or somewhere, they are teaching nanotechnology with no teachers. Right? And they are seeing the scores, the grades are continuously improving. Now this is not to say that we shouldn't have teachers. We should have a lot of teachers. Because it's tough to do that, because somebody must be facilitating all this content. But the fact is, the way we deliver, the way we impart the learning has to fundamentally change. Because today, if you continue to ask children to buy, my kid is buy-hearting poems. Great. I'm happy if she can at least, you know, say a poem for me when I'm stressed. But then that's not the only thing she buy-hearts. You know, she got to buy, she's just 5 years, and the amount of stress we put on that child to buy-heart things, I just don't see why that is. Even exams, I think this question, actually this was asked by one of my 7-year-old kid. Uncle, why can't we have cell phones in exams? Because then we can answer papers very quickly. We don't need 2 hours. Which is true. Because if a paper is 2.5 hours, if you can answer the paper in 1.5 hours by referring content, which is fine. Now, are you measuring memory? Are you measuring application? So fundamentally, something's got to change. Now, I don't know how to change that, and I probably will fall into trouble by saying this. It probably starts at a policy level, look at what do we want to do as a country, where do we want to be as a country, and then, you know, start making some fundamental changes. Now, the other thing is, just because you're educated also doesn't mean that you do it. Now, if you look at some of the more interesting people in the country, like maybe doctors, lawyers, they are not also the most honest people. So we've also got to impart those social values. I'm not saying all the doctors and lawyers are dishonest. What I'm saying is that there's a fair bit of people who do not so socially friendly things, let me put it that way, to be politically correct. But then, the other thing is, through all of these, how do you also impart all the different social values?